Well, good morning, friends, and welcome to the worship of God with McClure United Church. As always, we are just so grateful that you have chosen to join us. And it is our hope that during this time, you will find something in the prayers, in the music, the scripture, the reflection, something that will feed your spirit today, something that will connect your spirit to God's spirit and to each other. So we are gathered today on Treaty 6 territory, homeland of the Métis people. And it is so important for us to take time in our gathering to acknowledge and pay respect to the First Peoples of the land with our gratitude. And it's also important for us to continue to publicly declare that we are an affirming ministry in the United Church of Canada and have made as a community of faith a commitment to welcome all people, regardless of age, of class, ability, race, gender identity, sexual orientation. So please know that whoever you are, you have a place with us. And so I do have a number of announcements that I would like to share with you today. There will be a men's gathering on January 24th. And you can contact Norm Byram if you would like to join in on that. And Norm's email address is byram@shaw.ca. That's B-I-R-A-M @shaw.ca. And this information, all of the information I'll be sharing with you now, you will also find in the weekly email that has been coming out. And remember, if you're not getting that email and would like to receive it, you need to let the church office know so we can add you to our list. As well, we are starting an email book club at McClure. And so basically it's a book club, but all the discussion will happen over email. We're just getting ready to start reading our first book. So the idea is that we will read one book a month, and at the end of the month that email conversation will be initiated for all those who are interested in participating. If you would like to get in on that, please just let me know and you will find my contact information in many places. As well, you can contact me if you are interested in taking part in our new weekly Bible study. And so that Bible study begins on Wednesday, February 3rd, and will happen every Wednesday from 1 to 2 p.m. This will also be by Zoom. And folks from right across our region are invited to join us. Various clergy folks from Saskatoon and in other places have volunteered to help facilitate. So we'll get lots of new perspectives, and we will be focusing that Bible study on the lectionary readings each week. This study is open to everyone. No matter how much biblical knowledge you may have or not have, you are invited to come and to join in this conversation. So if you would like the connection link for that, we are asking folks to pre-register. So you can find that on our Facebook page, website, as well as in the email. And you can contact me if you have any questions at all about any of that. Also wanting to remind you that the Broadview magazine subscriptions are due. So that's formerly the Observer, for those of you that aren't familiar with Broadview. And so I am told that all renewals and new subscriptions must be received by the office on January 31st. And the subscription rate, it looks like, is $25. So you can contact the church office for more information about that. And it is an amazing magazine. And I really encourage you to, at the very least, go to their website or find a past copy to take a look at. There's many, many very engaging articles that I think many people would enjoy. And finally, our Lenten reflection book called Faith on the Move is now available. So this year, because of circumstances, we aren't ordering a bulk amount to have in office for people to purchase. We're just encouraging you to go ahead and order that book yourself. It's possible it will be used during some sort of Lenten study. but details are not finalized around that. But still, even for your own personal use, for daily meditations and reflections during Lent, it is a really fantastic resource. I've had a skim through it, and it does look quite lovely and engaging. So you can order that through the United Church book room, UCRD. It's ucrdstore.ca, but again, you can find that information in all of the various places I've previously mentioned. But I do hope that you will check it out. And if you have any questions about any of these announcements, you can contact the church office or Deborah or myself, and we will do whatever we can to guide you in the right direction. And I believe that is it for announcements today. So now we will enter more fully into this worship time.
In the deep of night, God calls to us. In the brightness of the day, God calls to us. God is here, in the still small voice, in the burning bush, at the side of the lake, on the road. God is here loving us, waiting for us to say yes to the call. Today we receive God's call, boldly trusting in God's strength, trusting in the light of God to shine in and through us. Let us pray. God of all people, you call our name and we don't always listen. You call our name and often we run in the opposite direction. You call our name and we are afraid that we will be asked to change our plans. You call our name. Call us again, gracious God. Push and pull us out of our complacency. Open our hearts to know your way. Make us bold. Make us strong. Make us yours. Call our name once again, O God, that we might say yes. Amen.
Today's scripture passage comes from the Gospel of John. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nazareth, can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. Come and see, said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, Truly, here is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. How do you know me? Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you. Then Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel. Jesus said, You believe because I told you I saw you under a fig tree. You will see greater things than this. He then added, Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. May God bless to our understanding these readings from Scripture.
So, in all of the gospel stories, before Jesus' career in ministry really took off, before he began teaching and preaching, healing, before anything else, he gathered together a small group of disciples. And this is where we meet up with him today. In the scripture that you just heard, we find Jesus in the middle of gathering together some new friends, friends who will learn from him and share in ministry with him. This is a passage about call to discipleship. And we talk a lot in church about discipleship. But what is it? What does it really mean? There's probably lots of different ways of understanding and describing what it means to be called into discipleship. But this is what it means for me. This is how I have grown to understand it. The call to discipleship has everything to do with a call to action. Discipleship is about how we live, what we've learned, how we share it, how we show it, how we live it in the world. As I said, there is a story of the disciples being called in each one of the gospel readings, but this one is just a little bit different from the others, particularly in the chat between Jesus and Nathanael. In this story, Jesus first found Philip and invited him to follow, and like the other disciples, Philip's decision to follow seems to be immediate. No questions asked, just ready to go. And Philip is so enthusiastic that he decides he wants to bring along his friend, Nathanael. Now, Nathanael, unlike the other disciples, is a little bit hesitant. He's doubtful. So Philip invites him to come and see Jesus for himself. And so Nathanael goes with him. And when Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he says, Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael comes to Jesus, and Jesus sees right through him, sees right into his heart. So no doubt, Nathanael is a little taken aback by the familiarity, and so he asks Jesus how he knows him. And Jesus says, I saw you under the fig tree. Now, I don't really understand what is meant by that, but clearly it meant something to Nathanael, because suddenly he knows that this isn't just nobody. He knows that this is the one sent by God. There's something about this part of scripture that really struck me. The thing about discipleship, the thing that is both awesome and a little bit terrifying, is that the journey with Jesus begins with being seen for who we are, being seen right to the depths of our hearts, being seen and still loved abundantly and completely. Isn't that a beautiful kind of friendship? One that maybe we've been searching for our whole lives, to be seen and still loved, invited into relationship? I wonder if any of you have seen the movie The King's Speech. If you haven't, you really should. It's one of those movies that is just good for the soul, but make sure you have a box of Kleenex handy. So this movie is about King George VI, who had a problem with stuttering ever since he was a young boy. But really, the movie is actually about the relationship that develops between the king and Lionel, his speech therapist, who arrived on the scene when the young king was forced into public life. Like other speech therapists, Lionel had his techniques, but he also had this way of being with people he worked with. Part of what is so beautiful in this story is how completely unfazed Lionel seemed to be by the difference in their social status. Here he was, no formal training or credentials, and working with a king. He wasn't a man of wealth or of privilege, and yet there's never a hint of him feeling in any way inferior. All there is his desire to help. And the kind of help that doesn't come from some expert training, but from friendship. And it's that friendship that makes this such an amazing story. Lionel found a way to come alongside this king and just make space for him. He made space for his insecurity, for his shame, his fear, for his hopelessness, his anger, for his desire. He made space for him, and he made space for all of his carefully guarded stories to emerge. He helped the king to see what was true. And he held that truth with love and compassion, and he helped the king to find the courage he needed to do what needed to be done. It's a magnificent story of power, of strength, of courage, and of the freedom that comes from a deep and trusting relationship. And Jesus offers us that kind of relationship. We as humans mess up. There's no doubt about it. We absolutely will. We make mistakes. We hurt. We disappoint our friends and loved ones. We disappoint ourselves. I think the best we can do is commit to righting the wrongs as they happen and to just work hard to be the best that we can be. The friendship that Jesus offers is different, though. It's a friendship built on faith. Just as Lionel stood by his friend, giving him strength and courage and tenacity and offering him a sense of safety, Jesus offers us the same. But he also offers us something more, because Jesus' love is not limited by human failing. That love is not even limited by our own failing, our own failing ability to receive and acknowledge that love. He knows us, just as he did Nathaniel. Jesus knows us and sees right through to our hearts. And still, he loves us. A love that endures all things, hopes all things, and never fails. We don't have to see or touch the physical presence of Jesus to know that this is true. That's what faith is. Faith is daring our hearts, our spirits, to go beyond what our eyes can see, what our hands can touch. Faith comes in all shapes and sizes. It's not easily describable. And it is experienced by everyone so differently. I can't describe faith to you. I can't tell you how I know that Jesus has called me to be his disciple, to share in his love and in his ministry. But I can tell you a story. It's probably a story that you have heard from me before. It's one of my favorite, and it's one that has had such a profound impact on me, and one that I continue to go back to whenever I need to be reminded of my faith. I was in my early 20s, and I was in a pretty bad place, just generally a mess, feeling miserable and pretty hopeless. And one night I was having myself a little pity party in my dark and dingy basement suite when I quite suddenly and unexpectedly found myself on my knees praying. Now, I was not at that time a spiritual person. I didn't consider myself to be anyway, and I was definitely not a religious person. I wasn't even sure I believed in God. And I don't remember my prayer specifically, what I said, but what I do remember very clearly is this new feeling, a knowing that somehow everything was going to be okay. I felt my anxiousness ease and a hope bubble up. I think what I experienced that night was an invitation into a friendship with God through Jesus. I knew that I was loved. And I heard the words, "Come, follow me." And I understood that that love had already always been there, but I had been reluctant to see it, to feel it. And I don't know, maybe it was my place of desperation, but that night something was different. I was changed. And soon after that, I found my way to the United Church. And my life did not immediately become butterflies and roses. In fact, it still hasn't. But it did, was the beginning of a new awareness, a new sense of myself, a new sense of my relationship with God, and a new friendship with Jesus. It was the best thing that ever happened to me, because it led me to where I am today, which is pretty awesome. But it has also demanded some things of me. It has challenged me, changed me. Because you see, the thing about a friendship with Jesus is that it isn't the kind of friendship that is content about talking about the weather or sports or the latest binge-worthy Netflix shows. It is so much more than that. A friendship with Jesus is discipleship. It's a call to action. Those words, follow me, are an invitation to be transformed. And transformation is rarely easy. For me, transformation meant examining my whole worldview. It meant looking at the stories of Jesus with the poor, with the oppressed, with those on the margins of society, and taking a good, hard look, an uncomfortable look, at my own place in society's power structure, and to think about what I was doing with the power I had. And as I read about the ministry of Jesus of healing and compassion, I had to look at those suffering around me. I had to look at my own self-centeredness, and I had to open my heart more to the suffering of the world around me. The invitation to a relationship of discipleship with Jesus turned my life around, and it is still a work in progress. I'm still not as good of a friend as I would like to be, and I still make choices that I don't think Jesus would be proud of, choices that probably hurt him, disappoint him. But I believe completely that even though I sometimes walk away from Jesus, that he never leaves my side. He knows my heart, and still he is always there, loving me, always hopeful. And sometimes that's kind of annoying. Sometimes I don't necessarily want to be seen. But as annoying as it might be, I would not change it for anything. Now, I know everyone has not had that same kind of dramatic entry into friendship with Jesus. But I have heard others share about their own more subtle, but powerful experiences of God's love. Like a flash of knowing, a sudden calmness in the midst of anxiousness, some sense of awe and wonder. I think Jesus has persisted in his friendship with us because he loves us so much, because he needs us so much. As disciples, we are called to action. And this action is to continue to live as Jesus did, to live as he called his disciples to live, to give it our energy, that friendship, our energy, our time, our passion. It brings with it a sense of peace and contentment. And I know that that peace and contentment that I experience is directly proportional to how much of my energy I'm devoting to that friendship, how much time I'm spending with God, learning, listening. So I think the question then is, how blessed do we want to feel? How blessed? How blessed do we want to feel in our lives? And that is the exact amount of time we need to spend with Jesus, how much time we need to spend nurturing our relationship with God. We need to make that time. And that time is here. The time is now. Even during a pandemic, we have to make time for God. The blessings are still here. They are here and they are all around us. We need to go seek them and live them so that we can offer them to others, so that we can be God's love in the world. So go be love. Live into your discipleship today and every day. Amen.
Here I am, Lord, is it I, Lord?
Let us pray. God, who set a light in the sky for the wise ones to follow, we thank you for the light that shines around us in our time. The dazzling morning light, mysterious moonlight, stark stormy afternoon light, and the rosy end of daylight. We thank you for the welcoming light of home, for the light which marks our way on unfamiliar roads, and especially for the welcome glow in a loved one's face. We thank you for the illumination you bring to mind and spirit, for the witness of your word, which is light to our path, the bright example of your saints, and the presence of your spirit. Especially we thank you for the light of Jesus, who brings us clear vision and penetrating insight, who shows us our meaning and calls us to your purpose. Fill us with light, God, and heal us of all shadows. Open our hearts that we might follow your way. In this precious time of prayer, we acknowledge places in our world where your light is hard to see. Places of war, oppression, hunger, homelessness, and poverty. Teach us to be light bearers in a broken world. God, as we begin the week of prayer for Christian unity, we confess the shadow of our fractured witness. We ask, God, that you would bless us with new energy for ecumenical conversations, that you would bless us with respect for traditions, that you would bless us with united passion for doing justice in the world. Today it is our joy to pray for our brothers and sisters and siblings of Holy Spirit Roman Catholic Parish. We celebrate the bonds that hold us in covenant with each other and with you. We thank you for your constant presence with us as we live out the challenge of unity to which you have called us. We celebrate the moments that together we witness to your love and light, and we ask that you would continue to guide us with your wisdom and grace. God, we would pray this morning as well for those who do not share the Christian faith, but who carry light into the world. Teach us respect and help us to honor all those who walk in love. God, we take a moment now to pray for those among us and for others who are having a particularly difficult time seeing your light. We pray for those who are sick or alone, or tired, or are struggling with issues of mental health. We pray for those who long to be noticed and those who would just like to rest for a bit. We pray for those who bear the burden of caring for others, especially in these COVID days. We pray for those who care for the ill and who are responsible for the distribution of vaccines. God, teach us to be light bearers in the dark seasons of others. And now, in a time of silence, we open to you the shadow places in our own hearts, trusting you will bring light to those places. God of light, to you we commend our dreams and our visions, our lives and our paths. Shine in our hearts and our minds. Be present in our lives. Continue to lead us into truth and wholeness. Continue to call us to the ways of light. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And so, friends, let's go from here to be the compassion of God, to be the love of Christ, and to be the companionship of the Holy Spirit. The world needs our friendship. So go in light and love. Go in peace. Amen.